What's up, everyone? I don't know why that I get kind of nervous on these things still. I know it makes no sense. I've been doing this for 5 years, but I just am very, it kind of freaks me out still. Isn't that weird? I don't have Billy here. Aaron is actually moderating the thing today, and maybe that's why, because I'm not used to doing this, and I don't see anybody coming on right now, but I see people on. I just don't see anything in the chat. Anyways, I didn't do my live stream yesterday like I normally do. Hey, I see everybody coming in now. Let's see here. We're going to talk about a classic album, and we're going to talk about it actually and talk about some things going on, some actual musical breakdown things, not like just listening. We're talking some music theory and stuff about what's going on, but about the Aerosmith Toys in the Attic record, which is a classic record produced by Jack Douglas, released in 1975 when I was in eighth grade. It's just a phenomenal record. It's a classic record. If you want to start a collection of vinyl, these are one of the things that I would put on there with Back in Black and Pink Floyd, The Wall, and Dark Side of the Moon and all the Zeppelin records. And, you know, if you want to get a rock collection going, and then you buy your Miles Davis Kind of Blue and John Coltrane Giant Steps, you mix it up, right? You get a couple prog records in there, some Yes, some Genesis, Trick of the Tail, and you start building your album collection with these things. But we're going to talk about that. The discount code for today's live stream, I'm going to have to read it here. So it's 40% off my new Quick Lessons course. Discount code for today's live stream is RB123. I run my sales through the weekend, although today is Sunday, so it'll probably go through Tuesday. I just was making a video yesterday that I'm putting out in a couple days, and that's why I didn't come on and and spending time with the family. So my ear training bundle, which I have bundled with a Quick Lessons course, which I did last week, $80 off that RB123. So you get both things at a really big discount. The Beato book bundle, which is my Beato book plus my YouTube transcription bundle and Instagram transcription bundle with that. That's once again, RB123, 60% off that. You want to support the channel, that's a way to do it there. The video I did with Pat Metheny, that was self-funded. Everything is self-funded on here. I don't have any sponsors, so that's enough of that. I'll come back to that actually, but let's talk about this record, Toys in the Attic. I want to kind of spotlight a few songs that are... And I disagree. Somebody said Uncle Salty is not a great song that keeps it from being a perfect record. I totally disagree with that. You guys all know Walk This Way. I'll play the beginning of that. This is one of the most sampled songs. Total classic. Okay, one thing I want to talk about is in the verse here. We're going to talk about this song just for a second. Listen to the two guitars. This is a really weird, cool, groovy lick that is a grooving lick that's has this really unique bounce to it that is very Aerosmith. It's not like the Stones. It's not like anything. It's very Aerosmith. Doesn't sound like Zeppelin. Really original between Brad Whitford and Joe Perry, who are two of my favorite guitar players. Listen to this. And then it goes back to the riff. Really iconic riff, iconic drum beat. Everything about this, obviously, you know that there was the Run DMC version of this, which really propelled Aerosmith back into the mainstream, honestly. And if you think about Steven Tyler, I mean, Steven Tyler now is still a star. I'm looking here on Spotify, and And it has over 300 million plays, as does Walk This Way and Sweet Emotion both have 300 million plays, which is really astounding for a record that came out in 1975. These are huge, huge hits still, right? One of the things about this song as well is the guitar solo at the end. It's very, really kind of a unique sound. Okay, so I've never been able to figure out what kind of a sound that is, but it's an amazing sound. It is an amazing sound. It just, it's this weird doubled thing. I honestly, to this day, I don't know how they got that sound. That's one of the most unique guitar solo sounds, I think. It's huge sounding. It's just this fat, fat sound. And then whoever's playing it, Joe or Brad, it's just amazing, right? There's like everything about this song. It's got a classic drum track. The vocals, you know. I like it. That's such a crazy, crazy groove. So good, right? And then the voice is like rapping. God, Steven Tyler's delivery is just so rhythmic, right? It's almost like a boogie-woogie. I love those. Just all those little muted, right? Great, great, great. Great guitar part. Now let's talk about Sweet Emotion for a second here. That's a bass line. Tom Hamilton. Really moody. What's up, Monty? Really moody intro. Oh. Use that little suspension. The voice box. Beautiful ambience. I mean, this is an incredibly well-recorded record. Perfectly produced. The hi-hat. Oh, yeah. Okay, let's talk about how great of a guitar sound that is. Forget the riff. That riff is amazing, but the sound is phenomenal, right? There's really no guitar other than the voice box till that verse comes in, right? I mean, this is incredible. So Jack Douglas produced this. He's one of the best producers of all time. Here's the riff. Beautiful reverb. Is it really overdriven? Just a great, great riff. The tuning of it, the reverb on the guitar, the distortion. Oh my God, it's amazing. That's just incredibly good, right? So. Great riff. Honestly, this riff, if you think about it, is kind of reminiscent of the riff in Back in Black. And this is 5 years before that. If you think about this, kind of the B riff of Back in Black, right? I can't play Back in Black here because it's the block. But this is really... So good, right? lot of reverb on the guitar there on that riff. So, so good, right? Anyway, so Sweet Emotion. I also love that fill that happens right there. Here, listen. Right there. Da, 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 da. Hear all those little backwards sounds that keep happening? But that, this was on my top 20 greatest bass riffs of all time. This is one of the best bass riffs ever in rock music. It's incredible. Once again, it's always in service of the song, though, because that's really the ultimate thing. It's one thing to come up with great parts, but coming up with great parts that work in great songs, right? Killer chorus, great guitar riffs. It's got a great chorus part, a signature bass, right? The bass lick is unmistakable. Aerosmith, you hear it. It's all you got to hear is Tom Hamilton's bass part, right? It's got a killer verse riff. It's got a great, beautiful melody in it, like everything about it. And then there's all the production elements. And to me, the perfect albums are the ones that also have a sonic signature that's consistent throughout the whole record. The types of reverbs using, the kind of the sonic landscape of the record, right? It has to have a consistent sonic landscape. Back in Black has a consistent sonic landscape. Pretty much every great record does. Doesn't matter what the genre is. You know, it's hard. It's interesting. The Beatles were one of the few bands that made records that were different from song to song, at least at first. But then when you get to Revolver, this is where you started to get that consistent sound of the psychedelic sound, the types of the reverbs and things, the parts, everything about it. About that record is really consistent mood wise, right? It's a sonic, it's a sonic landscape of the record. All the types of sounds that are used in it to create this thing, types of reverbs used, everything, right? What makes sense too? You get the producer Jack Douglas, who has real, all his records sounded great, right? It's just brilliant, brilliant, brilliant. Okay. One of my favorite songs, and I'm going to give you my discount code again here for today for the people who just joined it. It's RB123, so it's 40% off my new Quick Lessons guitar course. I just put that out about 2 months ago. It's got over 5 hours of video guitar lessons in there, but it's not a method. It's basically concepts, right? Just different concepts from video to video. 80% off my ear training course bundled with the quick lessons, right? It's $80, not 80% off, $80 off using RB123, and 60% off my Beato book bundle, 700-page PDF, okay? That's how I support the channel. Enough of that. One of my favorite songs in this record is this song here. This is a song that to this day I think it blows me away. Listen to this. This is called No More, No More. Okay, let's talk about that opening riff, right? He's doing this. It's an A sus thing. No wonder I love sus chords because of Aerosmith, right? So it's going from A sus two to E over G sharp. that's us too on the beat. It's really cool. Listen to it. Beautiful, beautiful. Listen. So the verse goes to this E vamp. Beautiful, beautiful part on the piano, though, right? There's two different parts. And the chorus. Love it. What really makes the chorus, the verse happen is the piano. One of the things I always think about with Aerosmith is the kind of the definition that they have in the parts, right? So the guitars, they're not that distorted, right? But they go dun da do da dun da da. They're always leaving little gaps in the rhythm, right, of the guitar part. Listen to that, listen to the guitar on the stops, right here, right here. Da 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 da. It's not da 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 da. It's always with those spaces there. That's what really creates that rhythmic propulsion, right? Okay, so another thing that Steven Tyler does, baby, I'm a dreamer. Okay, so this really was where I learned to love flat nine intervals, but I didn't know what they were, right? So he's going, baby, I'm a dreamer. And that note on that E or G sharp chord gives you that sus four over the first inversion. So that interval there, that dissonance there, makes it really emotional. That flat nine is, you don't notice it when it goes by, but it's a very melancholy sound when he says dreamer. Listen to that again. You hear, you'll notice, you probably never noticed, for those of you that know this song, never noticed that dissonance there. But it's really it's a really sharp dissonance. Listen. Again. Bridge, then change key. I love that. I mean, I love it. It goes dum do dum down, bum down, do da. And it's just so great there, that riff right out of the. Right here. Woo! Oh, great. Okay, so can we also talk about how Steven Tyler always sounded phenomenal? I mean, even now, the guy never changed. I don't think they ever had to change keys of the songs. This is 1975. The first record came out like 71. I mean, how's he keep singing these songs in the original keys? It's amazing. Guitar work is just stellar, always. Aerosmith's guitar work. Guys don't get enough credit. I really think that that the early Aerosmith records are just brilliant. They really, really are brilliant. And I think that not a lot of people. A lot of people knew kind of the second incarnation of Aerosmith, which happened in the 80s when you think of the Pump record, because that was a very big record. But these records, this record in particular, rocks. Get Your Wings. Get Your Wings has Seasons of Wither on it, which is one of my favorites, one of Steven Tyler's favorite songs. Anyways, these are just absolutely brilliant, brilliant records. And they're you know, performances, songwriting, everything is great on them. But to me, the stellar standout track on this record is this one. For those of you that watch my second channel, I've talked about this song. And by the way, I have a second YouTube channel that I've had for about 5 years. And I don't ever, I haven't talked about it on here, but I started posting videos on it. I started posting original content on it. It's called Rick Beato 2. I encourage you to follow me on there. That channel, honestly, is a place that I'm doing different kinds of videos, kind of like the videos that I did at the beginning of my channel, kind of whatever I want. I've got probably 70 some odd thousand followers there and everything, and I would definitely encourage you guys to follow it. I'm trying to get up to 100,000. So I can get my another 100,000 plaque instead of this little tiny one that's right back there. They make a nice big one like my million subscriber. I'm just kidding. Actually, I don't really care about that. Okay, so I want to talk about this other song, which is the last song on this record. And this is this was kind of a single. I went to see Aerosmith play on this. On this particular tour, this is one of the early concerts. I think I still have my concert ticket from it. Get Your Wings, 1975. They were really at their peak. I know a lot of people are like, you know, okay, Aerosmith was great in the 80s. A lot of my friends that are younger, like GL, Ken, my assistant that you guys have seen in some of my videos, he likes these early Aerosmith records and everything, but he grew up with '80s and he likes Pump and stuff like that. And to me, that was Love in an Elevator, those songs and everything. They're good songs and everything, Crazy, but they're not like this. This is really rock, right? Now, this song in particular, You See Me Crying, I want to talk about. Okay, all right, let's talk about the intro here. Okay, so the song starts on A minor, but it's really like A minor 11. Then it goes to F minor 9, or F minor 6. So A minor to F minor, and then it goes to C major. So it's a 6 minor, right, to 6 minor to 4 minor to 1. Really, it's very, very, very cool, right? I just love that. Right? And then they do I'm having a problem with my finger here. That's why I can't. It's very hard for me to. He does that chromatic run that's very kind of similar to the run in Maybe I'm Amazed. It's a great, great thing. It's an octave run he does from D. From D back up to A. It's really, really great. But that's a beautiful, beautiful. And then a beautiful modulation there when using that 4 minor. I don't know any songs. I'm trying to think of songs that go 6 minor to 4 minor. That 4 minor is a borrowed chord. You guys hear me talk about that. Chords that are borrowed from, that would be borrowed from the chord, from the parallel minor key, right? The 4 minor chord. And borrowed chords are just borrowed from other parallel keys and things. But a 4 minor chord is very, very common. You hear it, but you rarely hear it. You'll hear it, you know, you'll hear like, instead of F major, they do A minor as a sub, right? But that. What's great about that is that minor 6 sound on the F minor, because it evokes a certain kind of a mysterious quality, like a James Bond kind of a thing, right? And then continuing on. Then, Jesus. You see me crying. Don't let it get you down. You see me crying. Okay, so you're going, you see me crying. You see me crying. I'm sorry, it goes to F. Not cry. Then he goes to E. Then to A minor. So you're using a secondary dominant there. So it's you see me cry. The first time, it doesn't go to the E. The second time. Then to. Right? Oh! Okay, so this chorus is really, really amazing. It's beautiful harmonically, melodically. So that's like a C sus. But then he goes F sus to F, and then down to B flat sus. Then E flat major to D major. And then back to that C. Then, let's see. Then he does that walk up. I love it. When he goes from that E flat down to D major, E flat major, D major. It's like, whoa, what was that? Right? And then back to C. So it's like, duh, duh, duh. Beautiful, beautiful. Great guitar riff. I love it. The guitar goes right up that arpeggio. Listen. Comes down. You know. He's going right up E7, right? Listen to this. Say y'all are late. Beautiful. Okay, then the bass. Bom, 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 bom. Right? Goes up right up that E major, E7 chord there, right? The second time. Right? Pedal on G. Oh, yeah. So the really great. Goes that E flat, the C minor 7 to B flat over C back to C major. Killer, killer track. This song is really an incredible, incredible standout track on this amazing, amazing record. For those of you that don't know this record, this is Toys in the Attic. Aerosmith came out in 1975, produced by Jack Douglas. It's a brilliant, brilliant work. Everything about it. There's so many great songs on it. The song Round and Round you should check out, because to me, this is like a precursor of Alice in Chains, bands like that. Yeah. This is like Nirvana, Soundgarden, Alice in Chains. The grunge bands got it from this sound song, Round and Round. This is earlier than Rats. That's as heavy as anything that came out later. But that, once again, that to me is like the archetype for the grunge sound. That sound right there of Round and Round. That's a song right before You See Me Crying, right after No More. Just an incredible, incredible song. Check out this record. Once again, my sale for today, RB123 is the discount code. If you want to support the channel, buy something in my store. 40% off my Quick Lessons course, $80 off my Beato Ear Training Quick Lessons bundle. You get both things $80 off, 60% off my Beato book, Instagram, YouTube transcription bundle, 700-page PDF. But that's a way that you can support the channel. I've got some big stuff coming up in the coming weeks. The next week, like a week from tomorrow, I have a big video coming out that I can't talk about now, but you guys will be psyched with it. They're really cool. Anyways, you guys are the best. Have a great rest of your weekend, and check out my latest Pat Metheny video interview and my interview with Tosin Abbasi, Tim Henson from Polyphia, and Misha Mansour from Periphery. You guys are awesome. We'll catch up at a later date. See ya. Bye.